So I see a lot of new faces during the meetup whom I have not met before. Can I see a raise of hands, the new faces who don't know me before? Okay. So a little bit of background about me. As Veena mentioned, I currently lead the mobile platform team in SP Digital. And today I'm going to talk about iOS code signing horror. The earlier title that I put, iOS code signing internals that nobody would tell you, I thought it's a little bit strong. So I kind of changed the title to this. This is the agenda for today. We're going to learn about code signing in general and iOS code signing and look at individual components of code signing and how they fit together. You might have touched upon all these things while building an app or while going through the process of code signing, but there are some interesting things that I'm going to say. Again, a little bit of background about me. So I've been building iOS apps for almost 10 years now. Started pretty much from the beginning of iOS SDK. So iOS DevScout is actually my baby. So I started iOS DevScout in 2011. Then for the last 2 years, Melvin and other girls, they've been taking care of the meetup quite well. So you haven't seen me for almost 1 year plus. Then I, along with Melvin and a few others, organized iOS conference in Singapore. The next one is going to be in January. And I sometimes write articles on jayondelic.com. Again, talking about why you should care about course signing. Who hasn't seen this dialogue before? So if you have been developing iOS apps for a few years, you might have seen this dialogue where your code signing screws up and you have this little button called fix issue with the blue color. It's very, very tempting to click, but the moment you click on this, something screws up and a lot of people complain. A lot has improved over the past, but again, this is from Felix, the creator of Fastlane. Is code signing a real problem? Yes, a lot of people face it day to day. Even after the improvement of Xcode automatic code signing, the underlying concepts are still the same. And this is a very strong message. iOS developers don't understand code signing properly. That is because you don't deal with it every day. You just write code. You write in Swift. And a lot of time you just know how to fix a problem, but how it works, you, or rather, more than half of iOS developers don't really understand how code signing really works. So, coming to why we need code signing, just talking about signature in general, right? You sign on different things on a day-to-day life. The contracts, house agreements, offer letter, any legal document. So this ensures that the signed party is someone real and it's a trusted person. It's not someone like a fraudster or it's not somebody sitting in Nigeria signing on behalf of you. So that's what a signing does. The code signing for software is basically similar. It tells that the software has been signed by a legitimate developer. Not necessarily a good developer, but a legitimate developer. So your software might have bugs, but this is someone, this trusted entity can verify. And the software has not been modified or corrupted since the time it is signed. So that's what code signing is all about. And iOS code signing basically ensures that every app available on App Store are from legitimate developers. Developers who have paid $99 per year and Apple knows them. And apps once signed by this developer is not being modified by somebody in between. also it lets have good to control what software or what binary can be installed on which iOS devices. The first thing you do is you create a certificate signing request. You create a certificate signing request with the certificate authority. It usually involves creating a public key and private key, which I'm going to talk about in a while. It contains your information like email, country, signature, etc. And most of the time you use the Keychain app to create the CSR file. But let's look into what's underneath the CSR file. If you use the OpenSSL command line tool, then you can see what this particular CSR file contains. You can see there's the email of the person, there's the name, the country, and the algorithm that's being used to create a CSR file. And if you see the textual representation of this file, then you can see there's this public key that is part of the CSR file. Now, a lot of this thing happens underneath. You don't even realize that the public key got created, private key is there. But this is what happens at the very first step when you create a CSR file. Then creating a certificate. Now there are 10 different types of certificates which are available there. A lot of these things do different things. But the one that we're interested in is the development certificate and the production certificate. So this is where you upload your CSR file. Apple verifies this from you, then it gives you a certificate, and you can again see this certificate has your name, the issuer name, which in this case is Apple Inc. And basically this is the certificate that you will use to sign your code. And there is this file. The moment you install Xcode, I'm not sure whether it's after you download the certificate or the moment you install Xcode, but this file is there. Now, what does this file do? It's Apple Worldwide Developer Relation Intermediate Certificate. So the significance of this certificate is that it verifies all of the certificates in your keychain are valid certificates. It's not fake by somebody. So it's kind of an intermediate certificate that ensures the authenticity of all of the certificates in your keychain. Now, if you have multiple machines between which you need to kind of save these keys, then you export your certificates using this file called pkquery. So what pkquery does is stores your private key with a certificate. It has containers called SIP bags. And these bags have their own attribute and contain. For iOS certificates, we have one bag for the certificate and another one for the private key. So there are a few more things which are part of course signing. One is a team ID, one is a bundle identifier, one is app ID, device ID, and documents. Let's look into each one of them. The team ID is unique ID for your each development team. You might be part of multiple development teams. So your each development team will have a unique ID. Bundle identifier recognizes a particular app. The app ID is a combination of your team ID and bundle ID. And your device ID is the unique identifier of the device, which is a 14-digit number. And the entertainments are basically the capability of the application that supports. Now, while creating the app ID, you can put an explicit app ID or wildcard app ID. So the wildcard app ID could have something like the reverse domain name with an asterisk. Then with this particular certificate, you can build any bundle identifier that matches with this particular wildcard ID. But there are some limitations. There are certain services that you won't be able to use if you use the wildcard array. Now this is the meat of your cosigning provisioning profile. It binds all the things that we talked about, your certificate, your CSR, your app ID, and the devices. It's very easy to create multiple provisioning profiles for the same certificate. And if you do so, it's going to make your life hard. If you have both this provisioning profiles on your machine and then one certificate expired, then you are basically going to spend a lot of time debugging what is happening. Now this is the number of provisioning profiles that I have on my machine, which is not a good sign. I have about 132 profiles. Some of them might be expired. But what Xcode does underneath, it uses this command line tool called cosign. It uses your certificate, and once you create the binary, it uses the binary to sign the app. Now it has three steps. It has something called serial, it has digital signature, and then code requirement. So what is serial? So cosign generates a seal by running different parts of your code. It applies hashes to each and every part of your code. And the verifier uses the same hashing algorithm to verify that this code is legitimate and it has not been modified. Now, digital signature, on the other hand, validates the authenticity of the message. It creates the digital signature using the private key. And the sign hashes in the app along with the stylus certificate represents the digital signature. So if your app is legitimate, and once you run the verify command on cosign, you should see something like valid on disk and satisfy the required requirements. Now let's look into something fun. Are you able to download any app from App Store and tell that assign with your own certificate and tell that this app is being built by you? So I've downloaded this random app called File Browser. I don't know who built this. Hopes none of you in this audience didn't want to kind of reassign a popular app. So what it does is, as you know, your IPA files are nothing but it's a compressed file. You can just convert it to a JIT. Then you can see the payload of this IPA. And so once you open this, you can see a bunch of things. And this is where if your app has something in your runtime directory, it might show up here. But what we're going to do here is I have all the things that I've written here as a shell script. I'm just going to resign this app, and it's basically resigned using my own certificate. Now, can I install this app on my device? I resigned using my own certificate. At this point, no, because there is some additional layer of security that you need to remove before you can even install and use this app. But this resigning means that if I submit this app on App Store, Apple will know that this app is from me. It's not from somebody else. So again, what you can do with this knowledge, the other thing. So once you kind of have all the things, all the dots joined, then you can kind of understand how cosine works. Then the next time when you see something screws up, you can probably be better equipped to debug the problems. And there are actually various tools available by Fastlane itself to manage these things. One of the tools is Match. So what Match does is it helps you store these certificates and provisional profiles in a Git repo, so that anyone in your team, they can just use the Fastlane command and they will have the required profiles and required certificates. They do not need to create new certificates, new profiles. So I'm going to show one more thing about one of the issues that we faced. Recently what happened is that we have, as you saw, that we have a lot of provisional profiles. And at SP, we have the SP Utilities app, which are for consumers, but we also have a lot of internal apps that the SP employees use and some of the other stakeholders use. So the internal apps are signed by the enterprise certificate. So you use the enterprise certificate to sign the apps. And when you use the enterprise provisioning profile, there's an expiry period for this provisioning profile. And the time is, if I'm not wrong, it's 1 year for these profiles to expire. And Apple sends email to the admins when the profiles are due to be expired. So one of the popular apps that we have been working on, the profile expired. And the app suddenly stopped working, and the users were basically really upset about it. So what we did after that, we used another command, which is Fastlane specific. So this is a Ruby script. What it does is it will log in on behalf of you. It will download all the provisional profiles, and it will check the validity of this profile. So I'm just going to run the command and show you what it outputs. So you can see all these profiles are due to be expired in a month. Now there are few additional things that we have done here. One is the notification part. We have a notification that we send to Slack. Then we send this notification to the required developers by email as well. So it's not just one person who is going to receive the notification from Apple that this profile has expired, but the whole team will know that this profile is going to expire in 1 month or 6 months, and then you can do something about it. So that's it for my presentation. Any questions? Any questions? No?
For the first time, you saw the certificate in some platforms. Anyone in the team can accept them. Is there any security issue with that?
So for the development certificate, there is no security issue for that. So you you can create a team development certificate, and you can share it among the developers, and there is no security implications to that. But if your team members have access to the App Store distribution certificate, then usually for bigger organization it goes through a DevOps team. So the developers are not supposed to release the apps themselves. So it goes through a DevOps process. Then you should be careful about who has the key to the distribution certificate.
What happens if you submit the 5 minute app to the App Store?
So elements of this app itself, just the cosine part works. I would imagine Apple would have some other checks to catch the authenticity of the app. I have never tried that, but yeah.
Maybe we should try it now.
Any other questions? If not, I'm just going to give a quick summary about Mendenhood. It's a personal project of mine that I launched yesterday. It's a platform for mentors and mentees. So if you're interested, you can go and check it out. The two categories that I have launched with for now is for women in tech and startups. I'm going to launch more categories in future, but it's a soft launch for now. And yeah, thank you.